issues. Now, Cisco made this presentation, I think, to us about a year ago, kiddies, and it was quite informative. And I, and one of them, had great thoughts in regards to starting a program and starting to try to chase down somebody who owns these fire escapes, because my understanding is not our responsibility to inspect these fire escapes, but the owner's responsibility to have them certified like every 5 years. And I think the last time when I got off on another project, we had over 300 fire escapes in one of them, and that I didn't call my grandmother on one. But there was a whole program to disrupt the inside. But very interesting what Cisco was presenting you with in regards to what you should be looking for, some of the conditions that require some structural elements that might need to be replaced where you can and can't do. And with that, we'll give it to Cisco. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. I'm going to move today. Everybody hear me all right? What we're going to be doing is I'm going to change it up a little bit because we have a lot of people here that have seen this class before. Is that correct? So what I want to do is I want to take this class now to another level and say, let me show you what the rest of the country is facing just the same way you are, and just have an answered question. I'll tell you what's happening in Philly, what's happening in Cincinnati, what's happening in San Francisco, what's happening everywhere, and where it lays on the internet. So that way you can just say, well, if you want to do one, you just copy one. So for example, in Massachusetts, if you want to copy one, you can call Sean, is the local representative today. So Sean Shanahan, you can call him up and say, hey, how's the program going? They've been meeting that was for 3 to 5 years now. Everett is also. So you got Martin Furtado that brought us down there. You also have Jim Solter. Is Everett here? Here we go. So now we have a couple of cities who say, hey, somebody's been test driving this thing. But we'll also talk about Portland, Oregon, Seattle. And a lot of times, the only reason why I've ever brought out a lot of times is because it's somebody that's either injured on the ground or dead on the ground. So let's start off with the first story. And I'll show you a couple of stories. So I'll go through quickly on this, and then I'll get right into it. We'll open up the books. We'll stop looking at the stuff you have, and I'll tell you what everybody else is doing. And you can either choose to copy and paste, or you can reinvent the wheel yourself. You know, there's a hammer and a chisel and some stone out there. You can just build this from scratch. Otherwise, there's no insult in copy and pasting. So we've been doing this for over 10 years. And a lot of this is, as you may know, we never charged for this class. I teach this class from Seattle to San Diego, Chicago to Texas, and I've taught this from Maine to Florida. And if you go online and you type in the Fire Escape Seminar, you'll see all the classes. Even this class, as it's getting recorded, will get on. So if some of you meet that come to this class today, you can have to watch this class in about a week's time, right? So let's talk about where it's costing money. First of all, I had one case that I was an expert witness on in New York City, and then I'm gonna start playing a few videos for you, where somebody was visiting somebody's house on a typical, you know, 3 or 4 story tenement. They had a roof deck that was half legal, half illegal. And she used the fire escape to get upstairs. So she was visiting her friend, used the fire escape to get upstairs on the deck and up to. So she decides to come back down. The ladder doesn't extend all the way up onto the roof deck. The goosenecks is just a little bit of an intermediate thing down by the gutters. She had a couple of beers in her. She falls, she smashes into the third floor fire escape rails. Then she falls down to a floor below, thank God, because it had a flat roof below that. So she's a paraplegic. So they gave her, through the case, and I was the expert witness on that case, they gave her, let's see if we have $5 million, $10 million, $20 million, $30 million, $39 million. So she was visiting her friend, and she got a $39 million settlement. Now that's, sounds good, insurance will take care of it. Now insurance said, Barsky wasn't certified. The insurance company said the owner is going to eat this one. Anything over $13 million, there was an arrangement that anything over $13 million, they were going to kind of work things out. But she got $39 million, all on the owner. Next case, I was in Philadelphia 5 years ago, and it's one of the cases we're going to talk about today. Four people out having a birthday party, having a smoke and a drink. on a four-story building. Through bolts are all rotted out, they just fall, three people fall 40 feet, hit the ground. And you'll see the case here today. One dies when they get to the hospital. The other two, the girl that fell with that, the student, you know, from another country. So they sued the city of Philadelphia. And that was 5 years ago. And so that case has since settled. And I would not predict how much money they were given, but I can tell you what the knee-jerk reaction was in Philadelphia as of this year. They wanted all 20,000+ fire escapes examined immediately by July 1, 2017. Anybody have a calendar with them? And nobody knows how, there was no programming in place, so sometimes when cities get sued, these kind of things sometimes happen. And it's always going to round around money. So as soon as you have a dead person, a dead fireman, anybody on the ground, they're going to come right back to you guys. So out of 50 states, about 40 states, fire prevention does what you guys do. In about 10 states nationwide, building departments handle these fire escape inspections. Anybody know that in 2012, the International Fire Code took over fire escape inspections? So if you didn't know that, they finally fixed it in 2012. The International Fire Code now wants every building in the U.S. examined every 5 years and load tested. If you go to the 2012 IBC, guess what it says there on fire escape examination and maintenance? Fire code. So unless you are going to keep it, which I guess you guys are IBC 1001.3. Right now in the country, IFC 1104, and I'll show you where that is also. Okay? So a lot of times it's when somebody gets hurt, somebody's about to get sued, that's when all of a sudden everybody's not scrambling. So today, I'm going to show you a couple of videos. Let's move on quickly through this and let's dig into the stuff that I gave you. From Cincinnati, from Philadelphia. We'll talk about Portland, Oregon online. We'll show you everywhere where somebody has had some fatality, some issue, and out there they have a knee-jerk reaction. What we plan to have here, and we've done this with Lowell, we've done this with Everett, takes 3 to 5 years to implement any program. Because first it's the shock, you come in, nobody wants it, the mayor's gonna scream, all the men are gonna be freaking out because you're pulling ostrich heads out of the sand, and so 3 to 5 years. So this is not an overnight thing. So we'll talk about that. So let's go through a few, and then I'm gonna machine gun this. Usually this class is 6 hours long. 3 hours in the morning, mid-break, for lunch, and then in the afternoon we go out to the city and we go looking around downtown. We call it downtown walk around. So what you learn here, you're gonna be able to apply when you go out. So it's a 2-hour version. I'm gonna machine gun this. Is that all right though? At any time, I'll let you keep grabbing, raise your hand. If anybody has any examples of situations that happened in the city, I'd like you to raise your hands and tell us what's going on, because we have a few in here. So, fire escapes, what are they for? They're for egress and ingress, right? So a lot of times you have a building, a lot of people think, oh, it's for people to get out. Yeah. People are supposed to be self-evacuating, people are supposed to get out on their own, so that when a fireman arrives 1 minute, 1 hour later, they can get into the building. But when all hell breaks loose, this is the same thing. That they get out, right? Any firemen in here? No, right. So all the old, there is?
One.
All right. The only one that can answer this question. The old guys teach the new guys at the academy, and they're training them, and the academies have fire escapes. I don't know if it was Waltham or Watertown that I did the training tower there that I failed it because all the tracks fell. On the tower here, but in case of fire, the old guys teach the young guys, in case of fire, don't use the fire escape. You guys know that? Every fireman in the country is trained to stay off the fire escapes. So, what kills people in the first 3 to 5 minutes? Smoke, right? So you got a baby and a woman at the window, what's gonna kill them is not the fire. But the fireman is ordered and instructed to wait for a ladder or a truck. He is not allowed to get on it. Right? But if all of a sudden he's getting on this fire escape and he has one of these tags that you guys have in your thing. Hold this out here. There's cities that have this mandatory. on your fire protection system, and your fire code requires that every fire protection system have a tag. The fire safety fire protection system, and the fire code requires that all of them have tags. Do fire safety in Massachusetts have tags? No. But if a fireman is running down an alleyway and it's full of smoke, and this is affixed to the fire escape, 7 to 10 feet in the air, and it's white, there's only three colors. Red is out of service, yellow is in under repair, and white is a certified. Is he gonna wait for the truck? Can he run up that fire escape if it has a white tag on it? So minimally, what you're gonna be trying to get involved with is a safety program, a safe structures initiative. You call it a fire escape initiative, guess what happens? You're gonna get a call from the mayor. But you call it a safe structures initiative, guess what happens? What are you trying to find out? We just need to tag the fire escape in whatever condition it's at. So if it's certified, we'll get a white. If it's not certified, we'll get a yellow, and then we'll give them a certain amount of time to get it fixed. But if it's got dangling treads, put a red on it. And who's the first one to use that? Fireman? No, the tenant. Because what happens now when the in a house that has a red or a yellow sticker outside, and I'm paying a rent there. Hey, how come I have a red tag on my fire escape that my kids once in a while go outside on? All right. So we started this association almost 10 years ago. And it was all because of Hank Philip Ryan. Anybody remember Hank Philip Ryan? And she did that, that was right after the Station 9 fire. And she did that story, that fork. That's one of the greatest pieces we have. Just to make everybody understand, how old do you think this picture is? 60s? 50s? All right, fire escapes are built to 100 pounds per square foot. And we've had that calculated by engineers, because now in Portland, Oregon, they got a glitch in their system. They want you to load test it 200 pounds per square foot. But let me tell you what 100 pounds per square foot means, and why this is okay. A properly fabricated, installed, and maintained fire escape will never fail. The walls will come down way before a fire escape will ever come down. Because we've done the math. You have to be 2 feet square, 10 feet tall, and weigh over 600 pounds. And have everybody on every square inch of this fire escape to equal 100 pounds per square foot. So they already put in a double. It has a safety factor of 2. If we wanted to build this to normal people, it should have been 50 pounds a square foot. So that means when you have 10 people in a building that weigh 150 pounds a piece, and this is a 5x5 platform right here, can I get 10 tenants in a 5x5 platform? And if I did, that's only 1,500 pounds. I still got another 1,000 pounds to go. I'm gonna get 5 firemen that weigh 300 pounds, 200 pound firemen, 100 pound gear, and I put 5 firemen. Can I get 5 firemen in a 5x5 with all that gear? And even if I did, I still got 1,000 more pounds to go. So do you guys understand? Fire escapes were overbuilt. The only time they fail is when a connection fails at a tread, at a rail, or a connection fails into the wall. Everything else, it was so overbuilt. Every time somebody is on the ground, if you ever hear of a catastrophe on the ground, it's because the maintenance failed, not the fire escape. Got it? All right, tags. Portland and Seattle mandatory that every fire escape have a tag on the fire escape. You want to find out about it? Just go on to it, and I'll show you the websites. Every fire escape must have a tag. This is a departmental procedures and guidelines. A lot of people ask me, what should I do? A lot of times you're supposed to write up a little thing with your city's name on it saying, if you're going to inspect it, I want you to kind of follow this rules. Your interpretation of the code. If you're going to repair it, this is what I want you to do. And if you're going to paint it with today's EPA guideline, renovator license, no welding allowed on lead painted fire escape rules, write your own guidelines. Otherwise, copy this, copy and paste and drop it. You don't have to use any of this other stuff. So a lot of this is in Word or PDF. Just copy, paste, and put your spin on it. Got it? If you go online, and I'll show you this later, you go online and you go to Portland, Oregon, and you type in fire escape issues. Portland, Oregon, and I worked with them for 10 years. I've been working with them for 10 years. And they have the best program. You got a copy program, you copy Paul Lamarca. They already wrote out, go on the internet, everything's there, how to inspect, procedures, repairs, cleaning, painting, it's all there. You don't like what I wrote? Oops, they copy my stuff, thanks, but copy their stuff, copy, paste, drop it in, just that. So it all exists. You don't have to reinvent the wheel, it already all exists. Confidence test. You know there was never a confidence test ever in this US? And that's 25 simple questions. I have a copy of one. My first confidence test I built was for Seattle. And why did they bring me out there? Because they were proactive, or because four people almost got killed when the fire escape pulled from the building. And so they had a horrible program for inspecting fire escapes, and Portland was copying them, only to have Seattle come in and do something about it, and then Portland took it to the next level. So now Portland is the best program in all the nation, because we keep tweaking it. The only mistake right now is the engineers got in there, and they added, you know, so there was enough cooks in the soup, and they started adding salt. I mean, I already had added salt. They came in and said, no, more salt. So they don't want you to load test their fire escape at 100 pounds per square foot. They wanted 200 pounds per square foot. So we got rails popping, we got walls cracking, because we're trying to fix that. We sent letters in saying you misunderstood the safety factor of 200. It's already built in with 100. Because now they're saying everybody should be 2 foot square, 1,200 pounds, and they gotta be 20 feet tall in order for you to meet that requirement. And a lot of these walls are 100 years old. They're not going to take it. But, you know, that's why I'm going to run for class to say, hey, they did this, they got to 75%, they did this, they got to 60, they got to 90, and you got to sort of mash it all together and pick the best one you like. Because if you do anything, it's better than what we're doing today. How many have a program today? Look around. How many people have a program today in this city for fire escapes? Raise them high. Right? How many people have written, how many building inspectors have written a fire escape violation in the past week? Raise your hand. Nobody. In the past month, raise your hand. One. In the past 6 months, nobody, right? Know why? Out of sight, out of mind, the bastard child of egress. And if you do write a violation, then what's the first silly question that comes up to you? What do I do next? You're like, I don't know. Go on the internet and find out. That's what we always get. My building inspector wrote a violation, and I called him and says, what do I do next? He goes, I don't know. Call a professional. And they've ignored fire escapes for so long, there's no professionals left. Do you believe? My dad hijacked me into the business in 1971 when I was 11 and 12 years old, right? You know how many fire escape companies around the U.S.? I'm in. You know how many competitors there are out there that do roaring at the line works and railings and fire escapes? Yeah, plenty. Why don't they do fire escapes? Because there was never any money and you guys never wrote violations. Oh, and you guys always write the greatest violations, right? You know what you wrote for 50 years, if not 75? Scrape and paint your fire escape. So when they called up on a five-story building, they called around and said the first guy they called is a painter. And to paint the fire escape, you know how much he wants to charge? $3,000 to $5,000. And as he went up to give this guy this $3,000 to $5,000 bid in the Boston area, just to scrape and paint it, he said, hey, by the way, a couple of your treads are kind of, and a couple of your, you know, your brackets are kind of, and the guy says, oh, I think I know an ironwork guy. So he calls an ironwork guy down. And he calls Billy Bob Ironworks to come down. He comes out and says, let me take a look at your structure. He goes, yeah, I mean, I need to get it painted. But oh, I fix it and I paint it. So now he walks up the fire escape. And to properly restore a fire escape, not witch doctor repair, but welding, properly restore a fire story, you're looking at $25,000. So the owner has your violation in his hand. You're the only liberal violation. So he has your violation in his hand. He has one bid in. Building inspector, I mean from a paint guy, he has another one, so $5,000, $25,000, and you re-reads your thing, you know what it says? Scrape and paint your fire escape. So you should be writing on all your violations. Have your fire escape examined, repaired, tested. You just write those three things. Don't point out treads, don't point out brackets, don't tell them what you think is wrong with it. Just say, I want your fire escape examined, repaired, and tested. They'll call you back and say, what do you mean by examined? And you'll say, a design professional, others acceptable. What do you mean by repair? I mean no welding of rust into the connection. I want all the connections open and clean and remolded. What do you mean by tested? Well, you're either going to load test this upon completion as the code requires, or if you change all the bolts, guess what you eliminate? But you know this answer. What do you eliminate if you change all the bolts on the fire escape? The need for testing. You guys read that? The NFPA says it best. The authority having jurisdiction shall accept by load test or other evidence of strength. Guess what happens when you change every bolt on a fire escape every 25 to 35 years? Guess what you don't do to your fire escape for the next 25 to 35 years? And those are the easy ones. 95% of the fire escape, the bolts are all outside the building. What about that connection into the building? How do you verify that? You can load test that, now put undue stress on the wall, or do what? You can let sleeping dogs lie and put a new epoxy bolt in the building. Keep the original, put a new epoxy, now what have you eliminated? The load test. And you provided other evidence of strength. As clearly defined in the NFPA, but it's nowhere in the IBC what that means. Can't have that length. Overlap codes with yourself. And in the IFC. All right. So we're going to go over the confidence test later. 25 specific questions, and it doesn't ask a structural engineer or an architect or others acceptable to the city official. By the way, in the city of Boston, who is an other? Write on that document. You can pull out this book. I think I have a copy of this certificate. This is a Boston certificate. It says, engineer or a licensed builder. So is that another? What, fire escape guy, can he sign off on fire escapes? The law says he can. Does he have to pull a permit? Really? Routine maintenance on a fire escape, I have to pull a permit? The paint? So we got that. I'm going to scrape and paint my fire escape, I need a permit? Change one or two bolts. Oh, 10 this morning. Do I need a permit? Routine maintenance? When's the last time somebody bought a permit in here? Raise your hand. In the last 6 months, somebody issued a fire escape repair permit. I guess you just don't issue those either. You understand? So for 50 to 75 years, they've been scraping and painting fire escapes without a permit. They've been repairing fire escapes and welding them without a permit and or a hot permit, you know, for fire. And what happens? You guys remember this, right? Hank Philip and Ryan, 4 years ago, she came out and she went around the whole state. I'm going to paraphrase this sadly. The speaker doesn't want to work here for some reason, so. So to paraphrase this, because we're going to go fast to this. She basically went all around and found that this is not just a Boston problem. This is a statewide, it's not a regional and national problem. You guys had this happen in 2014, remember this? The fire on Beacon Street. The guy's welding on a fire escape. Killed how many? This was 10 years later that I did that in 2003. This is 2014. The same buildings that Hank Philip and Ryan talked about 10 years later were not certified yet. So look what happened here on this. They capture a scene. I don't know if they showed it already. The firemen and the place. Yeah. They showed it. They were working on this side, and they caught that shed on fire that then blew into the building. Caught those guys in the basement. welding is not an approved method of repair. You know why? A lot. The reason being, I'll explain. Anybody who's a welder in here? A welder? You can always verify this with a welder. When you take two pieces of steel, you put them together, you weld it. A fire escape has a bolt, because if this is representing the bolt, it heats up in the summer and does this, and a black fire escape does this. It needs to move. And when it cools down in the winter, it does this, and it needs to move. So 99% of every fire escape in the U.S., and I inspect them all over the U.S., it's rivets and bolts, because they got to do this. When the building goes through a little tremor, a little earthquake, it's got to do this. As soon as you weld it, what happens is, and I'm not saying you can't weld fire escapes, there's plenty of welded fire escapes that are hot dip galvanized. Guess what never happens anymore? When that weld is sealed from any future water intrusion. Now we can't rip that weld. So a weld, when it tries to do this and move, it stops microscopically ripping the weld. Does anybody concur with that or no? Right? So what happens is, and on a painted black steel, you think they go back and keep it painted and keep it sealed every 3 to 5 years? So what happens, it starts ripping the weld, and a lot of times, as soon as it rips the paint, or enough water gets in there, as soon as you get water, rust starts to grow. And it traps it, rust jacking. Now here's the biggest problem with a welded connection versus a bolted connection. And that's why you've been so lucky with a lot of your fire escape. The majority of every fire escape in your city is bolted. So when the welds don't stretch, they only snap. So as soon as they grab a little bit of separation, 1/8 inside that, it rips the weld. Anybody agree or disagree with that statement? 1/8 of thrust jacking in any connection will rip the welds. They snap, they don't stretch, welds don't snap. Take 70,000 pounds of pressure sometimes, but it'll just rip. Take the same connection you put a bolt in it, and the rust jacks, it'll rust jack for 5 years, and the bolt will hold. It'll rust jack for 15 years, and the bolt will hold, and it'll stop bulging like she's just, you know, she'll grow a half inch of rust, and she's eventually gonna give away. She'll eat through. But she'll scream and give you a heads up for 10, 15, 20 years before it finally says, you know what? And a lot of times when you've got rust jacking on treads, you know what you got? It's rust jacking on both sides. You actually see the tread bowing, you know why? Because she's compressing inward, and you got tread bowing. And you know why they're not falling? Because they're compressed. So the shaft is gone. You guys know how I know so much of this? I have a master's degree in reverse fitting. I was 11 years old. If anybody knows how to do it wrong, I do. Everybody's taking the trend of doing it right and doing it wrong. But I've also now know the right way to do it. But I've documented it to help you guys. You guys remember this? 1973? Back Bay, Marble Street. The Pulitzer Prize winning photograph. The fireman grabbed the ladder with one hand. He survived. Still alive today. I think they celebrated 40 years or something in the past couple of years. The woman died. Look at all the fire escape pieces falling, and her niece landed on her. You know why you have a 5-year rule? Because of this picture. So in 73, the rule in the country was, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And if you don't know it's broke, don't write a violation either. But after this, they started the 5-year rule. Massachusetts was one of the few states that had a 5-year rule. The IBC rule started with this picture. 30 years later, what do we have? So we're not going to start a fire escape program here. You got to make it a part of a checklist. You know what they did after that piece went up with Hank Hill Shrine? They made it so that you have to, if you're pulling a permit, you have to close it with a certificate. That's what they decided to do in Boston. So we started getting a lot of calls in Boston because you couldn't close your permit until you did your fire escape certified. And we're telling you that the permit for the fire escape, or the repair of the fire escape, should be first, not last. Because OSHA requires, during renovations and alterations, you must maintain 2 means of egress. That's another piece of the code that we'll show you that's sitting there. So does that mean you fix the fire escape first or last? So that's all it is. You make it a checklist item. When you bring in permits, people are filling out permits, you're just asking, just pick it apart on your checklist. Right there, you're gonna start catching a lot of people saying, hey, I'm fixing my house, great. You have an interior or exterior fire escape? I mean, stairway. I have an exterior, wood and or steel. Because you guys know that's your code, right? All exteriors, little wooden stairs, balconies, bridges, then fire escapes. Nobody's doing the wood structures here? Staying away from those right now? So, our job is to make this a checklist item, so you don't have to work at it. You're not gonna go looking for fire escapes until you're gonna find you through a normal checklist process. Okay? This is a fire escape right here. It came out of Cambridge, out of school. And what I did is I say that this was in kindergarten through eighth grade. And I'm gonna stop right after this and we're gonna get right into questions and answers. And what I did is I did everything wrong to it. So I saved a piece of this fire escape on a school, and this staircase fed the yard with kindergarten kids every day. So who called me? Was it the fire marshal during his yearly inspection? Was it the building inspector? Was it the teachers who walked out on this every day? No. Was it the little kids who were eating all the lead paint off the thing? Because there's no more lead paint on this thing. Look, that's the way I found it. Exactly. What you see there, see the orange? A little bit of orange lead paint? Or was it the maintenance guy that says you need to change this fire escape during our Christmas break? So what I did is it was a lot harder trying to save a piece from collapsing. And I brought this one on the last show. Remember I had from Rusty? And we had it here, we used it as an example. But basically what I did is I did everything wrong. That a welding witch doctor, that's what we call him today, a welding witch doctor, goes in, this is how he cheats and does a job for $3,000. That should be $15,000. That should be $25,000. He does it for $3,000 because he does this. But you can't weld, it's a $37,500 fine to weld on anything that has burn, anything that has lead paint, right? But just so you know, we're not excluding welders. They can fix fire escapes. They gotta leave the welding machine at home, they gotta bring their tool, they gotta break bolts and put bolts. So those guys are qualified to do this, but they're welding, they've been getting away with murder for 50 plus years. And also, as you know, in 2014, they did what? They actually committed it. Right? So this is wrong. This is where you put a clip on top. And you weld, you spot weld. And what do we have? Certified welders doing this, or just guys who are learning how to weld? Right? Look at this. Don't, you know, rusty bolts, what do? You weld the nose. Leave the bolts. Weld the nose, this is very typical. You're gonna see in a lot of these old houses that are 100 years old, ready to burn, these guys show up with a welding machine, they weld the nose. Where's the rust? It's still inside. Weld it from underneath. This is why I have a master's degree in reverse engineering. I thought this was going. I'm gonna stop a car thief. Who should invent the best car, anti-theft device for a car? The burglar, right? One of the great. The pocket on your pants that you can't pickpocket, what do you call it? Call a pickpocket. So this is what the fire escape looked like, and what I did was 4 feet across. And I shrunk it down so I could bring it to shows. And I left one side totally wrong, and I did the other side totally correct. Look at all the lead paint, there's no more paint left. This is where it was in that yard, in that school. And this is what it looks like now. And you know, instead of coming out where kids can bump their heads, I put it up against the building. But it was the maintenance guy that called us this. Alright? So, Russ, let's start. Let's open up the questions first. And I'm gonna start digging into the books of the things I'm giving you in front of you. So let's start opening up some questions. Who has a story or a fatality or something that's happening in this city that they have a question? And again, I know the code to a certain degree, because I deal with 50 states, but hopefully if I get caught on a code issue, please, I need you guys to sort of help with any code questions, because some people have one interpretation, while other people have another. Questions? Great. Yes.
The main problem I think we all have is that we don't have the resources all the time to address them. If you go to the town manager or your local mayor and say you want to start a program or a need, you want a guy to go survey and put stickers on fire escapes, and they prioritize it, put it on the capital list, 5 years from now, go away.
So every other state has had the same problem, so just make it part of your checklist. So again, don't start a task force, don't go looking for money. You're gonna pull a permit in my city, as part of your check, you know, architect seal, stamps, drawings, this, that, and that thing. You tell me, do you have an internal or external fire staircase? External. I need it certified. Now, in case the fire scene is a train wreck, do you still stop the job? If you stop the job, the mayor won't call you. But the law is very, very clear. The OSHA states that you have to maintain 2 inches of egress. There are alterations, document there. You have to maintain 2 inches of egress. So can I put up scaffolding while I'm doing my demo on the building and while I'm doing whatever, in 1, 2, or 3 months? Can I negate the fire escape? Can I block all access to the fire escape and then to the fireman on the outside? Can I just block it and say, don't use it and put up a full set of stairs? So the OSHA says they can. That's a second means of egress. It's not permanent, it's temporary. So that answers your question. And you don't need to go find them. Just add it to the checklist. One by one, they'll be walking into you. Hi, I'm pulling a permit, I'm changing the light bulb. Hi, I'm putting it in the toilet. Great. Why do I need a fire escape certificate if I'm just changing the toilet? Because during construction, that's when most fires start. And we got to make sure that the people have 2 minutes of egress out, including the workers who are about to install this toilet. About the OSHA requirements, so now you're being an OSHA. You're saying, and it's required that you, during alterations in construction, and there's an actual code. I'll give you the actual code. It's on the sheets that I gave you, so don't create a task force, add it to a checklist. Now, there's another checklist. Every time you get a sprinkler system, should the sprinkler system also include a fire escape affidavit? Because the sprinkler company is not inspecting the fire escape, they're getting a copy from who? From the owner. The National Fire Code mandates that every fire escape in the U.S. now must be inspected every 5 years since 2012. Well, it's a 5-year requirement anyway, so the sprinkler guys say, hey, I gotta submit this in, whether they're doing any form of fire protection. When you do a health, you know, when you empty a building, you do a health code violation, before you put the people back in, isn't there some sort of checklist you gotta go through that says it's a safe building? From water, mildew, and all those other things, don't you think? 2 means of egress, certified, is one of your checklist items. So the way to get that is, don't put money into this, just say, add it to a checklist. So fire department should be working with you. So the fire department, the last thing they sign off is a smoke detector. Guess what he's supposed to add to the smoke detector sign off? A copy of the certification. If he's there and he's signing off on the smoke, and the guy doesn't have a copy, that's not gonna be the fire department. He's gonna sign off on the smoke. Let the guy do the building, but he's going to notify the building department that it's an incomplete smoke detector sign-off. And you're going to send out the notice for 30 days. So it's just add to a checklist on everything. So every checklist that already exists, put it at the end. Pencil it in for now until next year when you get the new prints. Just pencil it in. Fire department, building department, and health department. Can all be leading information back to you that something's incomplete. They'll still complete their process. Don't let anybody stop. You stop the money train and they will hang you from the highest tree. Does that answer your question? Checklist, and we'll cover that at the end. Checklist, just add it to the checklist. Other questions? Shout out. Problems, anybody? Yes?
Fixed glass is a lot of cases in the room. You have a ladder outside of it and you know it. It's about 50 years ago. Will those ever come out?
Oh, a ladder question. We have a ladder, not an actual fixed window. We have, the king of ladders is bobblehead. We have a great case from 1960s. So let's talk about ladders. First of all, you know it was approved in Dean's Beaver. So let's start with 1900, people started putting up fire escapes. And it was all you needed to meet the means of egress in the 1900s was cross over a firewall. This window went to that window across the firewall, it was legal. And even today in Boston, you got window to window fire crossing firewall still pre-existing lawfully non-conform. Right? It's a great word. You went to court over this, right? Not me, I was part of this, but yet pre-existing lawfully non-conforming on the date of its installation, which means you don't have to upgrade it, right? So now let's talk about your ladder. And I've seen this, the Home Depot ladder up against the window. That's illegal. The ladder to the side and a platform that you step out to that you then feed this ladder that's made in Home Depot properly installed. Now is illegal. So the ladders are always illegal if they were properly installed and permanent. So sometimes you get that it was never been permanent. They shoehorned it in on a Saturday night. So it's up to you how you want to handle it as a city. But otherwise, a ladder to a window is not, to me, it's missing one piece, missing five. That's how I would write it. And then I would put it as a pre-existing condition back to the building inspector, how you want to handle it, because in some cases you say, you know what, it's a pre-existing condition, what do we have to do to make it better? And at least legal in 1962, you can say, well, it needs a platform, that you get out the window, crawl over, and then go down the ladder. And by the way, all ladders are too degraded. If you read your code back in the day, it says that the last portion, which is up to 9 feet, can be a swing down or a guilty ladder on a cable or a cantilever stair. And guess what people read? They read next to the 9 feet and they what? Stopped. So every fire escape that you have is a ladder that's 8, 9, 3, or 10 feet. The way you test it, and if somebody wants to give you a hard time, they say, listen, the law says it's supposed to be great, and you can be up in the air so it'll be racing and stuff like that. But if the guy wants to be really hard about it, so listen, your mother around? Can you have your mother show me how easy it is to jump from 9 feet in the air? Can you tell the guy's 75-year-old mother, come down the stairs, down the ladder, and jump around? She doesn't break her ankle, her knees, or hip. You might let it slide, otherwise all ladders are to the ground. Well, they have to have a slide to the ground. But ladders are allowed today? Nope, can't do a ladder today. That's a great question too. I have a wooden one. I have a metal fire escape to a wooden ladder, and it's all rotted, and I replace that ladder. Some people say, yeah, you can replace it in like and kind, so I can go from wood to metal. And sometimes they say, no, you touch that, and now I want a brand new fire escape, and I want doors where there's windows. Anybody want to play that game? Punch each other? So I've had that happen. Has it happened in Taunton? Anybody here from Taunton? No? It happened. And it went up to the three-member board, we call it the appeals. And they said, yeah. Well, this is how crazy it was, ready? Taunton, typical one-family house converted to a three or four family. So it came out of the attic onto a little roof that had nothing on it. To a ladder that came down to another little roof. And then from there, it was a little bit of slope. They said, oh, from there, you need to create a platform and a full set of stairs to the ground. I said, no, it's missing a component. It's missing a piece of it. It's intentional use day one when they built it was coming out the window. It needs a platform that guides you to that ladder. It's already fixed there. Come down this ladder. You can't be on a slippery roof on the second floor. You need another platform to guide you over to the edge and then another ladder to the ground because it's missing its components. Catwalk on the third, it's missing a platform on the second, and it's missing the continuation of the same system which is left. But I don't get to call that, I throw it back to you. Tom said, nope, from here on, full stair. And that's what they got. Full stair to the ground. After the ladder on the second floor. So I said, so what you're saying is that guy's house that is 5 feet off the ground. I can't extend that ladder to the ground anymore. So I can put a platform at 5 feet off the ground and put a full set of stairs. So I'm going to have a ladder, feed a platform, and then step down 5 steps. So the law gets kind of wacky out there, but still left. Got it? So does that answer your ladder question? So any ladder to a window is illegal. As soon as they put a platform on that, then it becomes, to a certain degree, legal because you're feeding the ladder, and the ladder is great. But you still need to go in the in the jacket of that, you see, they won't permit. Because every now and then, depending, it's your call. Anybody want to chime in on this? If there's never been a permit pulled even for that Home Depot ladder, what could you force the owner to do right there and then? Set of plans. Coming out window? Second to egress? Right? So it's got to come out the door. Right, platform, and stairs to the ground, and the last piece can be a cantilever, can be a ladder. No ladders ever allowed anymore. Questions? Yes?
One or two bearings you get from these fire escape requirements. That one or two family rule.
Anybody want to chime in on that? One or two families exempt for two means of egress required on all structures.
Back of a
question. Good question, so. So, you read the Mass Building Code 1001.32. Read it on the back. Everybody flip to this thing. I'll read it slow. Testing and certification for 1001.3.2. All exterior bridges. What's a bridge? Steel or wooden stairways. Have we talked about fire escape yet? Fire escapes and egress balconies shall be examined and or tested. So, these wood decks on the one-story building on the back, these porches that accumulate the what, bicycles and cans, and nobody goes outside if there's a mosquito outside nowadays. If the temperature ain't perfectly 68.7 degrees, low humidity. That was a Facebook good day, right? You go back and talk about your neighbor's clothesline, right? Well, so all these stairways in the back, made of pressure treated wood or plain wood, no paint? Are they covered on the 1001.3? All that believe that it is covered, raise your hand.
That's the building code.
1001.3?
Yeah, IBC.
IBC.
IRC. They're referencing the building code for commercial.
Right.
Not one, two, three.
Well, that was his question. Yeah. So, my question to you guys, who does know the answer to his question? Because you're not referencing IRC, right? So what do you do with a two-family rotten rear wood? That happened in Chicago. How many people are killed when the deck collapsed? The rear porch?
29 people.
Yeah, well, just 29 people died. So how do you want to handle that, guys?
Certified.
Well, not me. I'm not saying I'm asking you because this is the issue. How do you get this brought up to the thing? Because one and two families have been hiding their sacred cows. You don't touch them. Does that have to be life safety issues? If it is danger issues, that's the only time you're going to bring. So, anybody want to make a suggestion? What would you suggest?
Unsafe structure.
These are all great ideas, but who's going to, is it a mass? Is it going to be top down or bottom up? Because some of the greatest activities that we've had hasn't been from the top down to the state or from the bottom up. Locally, in your own city, doing something. Okay, next question. You guys have some questions? Let's open up and see what the rest of the cities are doing. Open up your book. Let's start off with this page, the one that talks about Philadelphia and Cincinnati. Okay? So, Philadelphia and Cincinnati. Cincinnati now has joined, and they want all fire escapes examined by July 1, 2017. If your building's 100 years old, if your building's 75 years old, they want all buildings examined by 2018, July 1. If your building's 50 years old, they want all buildings examined. And that's their sheet. And they have some international fire code documents that they're using because this is run by the fire department. And as you can see here, it's a pretty simple task. We took this, like Philadelphia did, from the facade inspection. So if you ever looked at a facade inspection document, they just took out facade and they put in fire. Now the only difference between Philadelphia, because that lawsuit I think had a good pitch. And by the way, I have inspected in every corner of the US. Who do you think has the worst fire safety in the nation? Philadelphia. They're the kings of the worst fire escapes ever. I gave a class to 50 L&I inspectors 6 months before the fatality. And I told them it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Okay? And 6 months later, we got a fatality. Since then, how many times have they called me to public drag such as that. Now, as a matter of fact, last week, I got a call to that we're inspecting. They want 20,000 of these inspected by July 1. Right? The Archdiocese wants us to inspect 2,000 and they got an extension until January. Because they got 2,000 building for insurance. As far as the worst parts, examiners. I've been examining Philadelphia. Yeah, it's my own opinion because they won't. Yeah, it's my own opinion, yeah. But just from everything I've ever seen, and if you want, you can even go online. A lot of my stuff is documented out for public use. And a lot of it has been cleaned of any address or whatever. Just have the fire state inspection in Philadelphia, and then fire state inspection in Chicago, fire state inspection in Boston, and you're definitely going to see every Philadelphia inspection is a rotten piece of steel. So, but here's what they did that's going to be a problem. They mandated only in Philadelphia, not the state of Pennsylvania, because I have caught
Penbach.
With ICC approval, I had caught Penbach. It's Penbach North, Penbach South. Okay? And Philadelphia said only structural engineers can inspect their fire station. And they hadn't inspected these fire stations in many, many years because there was never any money they had to inspect. Nobody would even repair them. So outside of Philadelphia, structural engineers, registered architects, and others acceptable. But in Philly, only structural engineers. So that made it even harder. And then they put a July 1 deadline. And this just came out in March. Over 20,000 fire stations. And they only give you three options. Safe condition, which means certified. And then they want you to load test it. Safe with repair maintenance program, which we thought was a yellow tag. Like, oh, it's ready for its intended use, but it needs to repair. Like, no. That's safe, but needs a paint job, and we might let the owner not paint it for 5 years. And then unsafe condition. Okay? So, unsafe within the danger. The only option we had, we didn't even have just an unsafe. So there's a lot of back and forth saying, well, you know, there's a lot of these engineers don't want to sign this document because when you read their declaration down here, it said that they delivered a report, a repair report, and we're telling them, no, all we've delivered, not just us, everybody else, is an opinion, you know, the first pre-evaluation. No, they said, no, we want you to do a report that tells you everything that needs to be done. I mean, we need you to do it right off the bat. So a lot of these reports cost $3,000 to $5,000 to put together because you have to describe the job, you have to describe the bolts, you have to describe the paint, you have to point out where it is, three visits, drawings. Do that the first visit. So a lot of times, so the city was expecting that every engineer was just ready to do these for $300, $500. And so this is just a mess down there because, but it's okay, it's the learning curve. If you want to copy a program, I like their sheet because it gives you a lot. One of the things I like about this sheet is when's the recommended start date. If you look at Cincinnati, it's very plain. There's not a lot of information. But look at Cincinnati. They gave me four options. Safe with ordinary repairs and maintenance, which means non-structural, paint-related issues only, minor stuff, ready for its intended use, and you can load test it. Unsafe, which means, hey, you can get on this thing, which is unsafe. And unsafe within the danger means treasure inspection. So I like the four options here. They just need to make the four options here, not three. But I like the rest of the stuff. If you read this document, so copy and paste this. I even have a letter that they sent out to all people. If you haven't drafted a letter, just copy their letter. Go just go Fire Escape Philadelphia letter. You know, send it all on the internet. All this is on their website, philadelphia.gov. Biggest problem with them, they want you done, they want it all done by July 1, 2017. Did you guys help them? $1,000. It's not to send out the fines now, like, live in Philly and just keep it. I mean, and everything I look at, failure or imminent dangers. Failure is an imminent danger. Failure is an imminent danger. I didn't tell you that. I went back to the case that I was an expert witness on. I went back to them last week. They hired me to go look at a job. And one of the addresses, the address was Locust Street. It's down by City Hall. Locust is the oldest part of town, the Locust and Spruce and all that stuff. But this is actually 22nd Avenue, so it's out of the park. When I got there, I recognized the address. So I inspected this fire escape 5 years later. Pass or fail? Failed. Probably they replaced all the platforms with epoxy bolts or sleeve anchors. Sleeve anchors. Everybody likes sleeve anchors? Right? So here I am. It's kind of ironic that 5 years later, and it's just, I mean, two dots have crisscrosses on it. I didn't pick this. This was like, yeah, I didn't just at 22nd Avenue. Now I got to walk in where I was never allowed to walk, and I walked. There's many documents you have. So guys, I like the sheet because they make it ask for the stamp. And it says here, you can call, and it asks for the owner. The owner must sign this and say, I have seen this document. And this is an attic. So let me tell you what I sat down with the building commissioner or the director in Cincinnati. Let me give you an example of what I think you may want to test drive, and I'd recommend this to that. Sometimes to go right off the bat, stop banging people with $5,000 to $25,000 problems on these residentials, you gotta freak everybody out. But they've ignored it for 50 to 75 years too, so it's catch 22, you know. They knew better, but they collected all their rent. So they haven't spent any money on it because they kept all the rent, they haven't put any money into maintenance. But what we recommend, and this is all about liability, what you really want is a safe structures initiative, and all you want to do is basically say, I want your fire escape examined, a preliminary examination, to see if it's ready for its intended use. From its intended use declaration, you get the preliminary report back, and the preliminary report will tell you the type of tag that it needs. Will it be a white tag, or will it be a red tag? So guys, if it comes back with a white tag, guess what you want? That's great. Are we load testing it, or are you bringing me, Mr. Structural Engineer, Registered Architect, others acceptable to the building official, are you bringing me other evidence of strength? And he said, yeah. All the bolts are changed. I did the 25-point checklist. There's no internal rust anywhere, and I verified the connection to the building, or I duplicated with new epoxy bolts. Will you accept that? White tag. Would you go through the National Fire Escape Association, and we've got these tags made out of aluminum, and there's a company that wants to use the National Fire Escape Association to keep not only a record of every fire escape in your city, because they're doing that, this is Philadelphia. They want the citizens to go in and punch in their address where they have the fire escape. How would you like to know where that is? Well, we're signing a database, and you can actually go look up, because you're going to be shared information, where all these fire escapes are. But you get a white tag. If it doesn't, what you're going to get is a yellow or a red from this initial ready for its intended use. So they're going to get this, these dangling treads. It's still a preliminary, there's no full-blown report, there's still no $3,000 to $5,000. So these engineers don't want to get their feet stuck in the mud, you know what I'm saying? Because once you own it, you own it. Nope, this is a preliminary, I got dangling treads, I got a wall bulging, and I told the client $5,000. I told him to take a hike. Said, not a problem, I collect my $3, my $5, my $700 of a preliminary examination. I photograph and I stamp this little document and I send it back to you and says, hey, this guy told me to take a hike, but I got his signature here. It says that he's aware of the condition now, you deal with it. And when they say, oh, he's too expensive, I say, great. You got a phone book, right? Keep pounding. Until you find something that's cheap enough for you, because right now I'm gonna shut that building down. Or I'm going to order scaffolding. What's cheaper? Shutting a building down, putting everybody out on the streets, or ordering scaffolds for residential or commercial buildings. And do you meet the code? Do you meet the code? OSHA says you meet the code. You need two legal means of egress. And who decides? decides whether that's, that scaffolding is authorized? Who puts it up? Do you know anybody? Or a scaffolding company? And do they put up a construction scaffolding, or they put up second means of egress scaffolding? Do you go there by yourself, or you bring the fire marshal with you? And when you and the fire marshal look at this beautiful new scaffolding, and they mothball the fire escape from the inside so you can't get on it, they've marked it on the outside so firemen will never use it, how long can that go on? How long can that scaffolding go on? 6 months? A year? You gotta drag it through court, do whatever, right? But you need these tags. So when you start doing the safety initiative, it's called ready for its intended use. Now here's the best part about the legality of, or the liability. You have to have some strong disclaimers. It says it's not certified. It is the opinion of that architect, that engineer, that others acceptable to the building official, that the fire escape is ready for its intended use, but it's not certified. It has rust or some issues with it. But the owner, during the process, while it's under this ready for its intended use preliminary, who has all the liability for that building? The owner. Until it's certified, it does not cross the line over to the engineer within the load testing or other efforts of strength. So you basically say, I need to initiate a safe structures initiative. I just need to see if it's ready for its intended use. So your first wave in the first 1 to 3 years is really just looking at buildings. You put out a document through your taxes, you know, everybody gets the tax every 3 months, every year. You just put a flyer inside that says, hey, 1001.3 says you must have built minimally to not face a fine of $1,000 or $500 or $5,000. I don't know what you guys want to charge. You must minimally have a preliminary, it's called pre-evaluation, done on your building, and tell us what's your current status and get a tag on. And if it's ready to go, you get a white tag. How soon can you load test it? 1 to 5 years. So if you guys are happy with an engineer stamping it, but no load testing, that engineer is going to have a disclaimer saying what? Who's liable if anything happens on that fire escape that was never load tested? Still back to the owner. If you accept it, what happens? Ask your legal department what that means. But can you give somebody a 1 to 5 year reprieve to load test if they got a white? You know what I'm saying? Now, if they got a yellow, you want to play the 3 months to 12 months rule with them? So listen, you got a yellow tag on that, I need some sort of program started on this that you're going to come, you're going to attack this. Because right now, based on your engineer's recommendations, the recommended date is 30 days. So you know what? Get going on it. Do something. Show me that you're making some, you're doing something about it. If the thing is red, we're going to put a red tag on it. What are we doing? The building department, the fire department are showing up and talking to the guy. So listen, we're not even worried about all this business. We got occupant safety here and fireman safety. So let's get these scaffolding up. Or look at this fixed wire, pick one. So I think that you can put off the load testing because you guys have accepted, you have been accepting, because a lot of you guys just copied the Boston certificate. Everybody knows the statement here, right? It's on the standard issue document from Massachusetts, right? Want to copy that and collect? $50 or $100? $100. Boston collects $100 to put this document somewhere. $100. And all it says here, this is a fire escape and fire balcony affidavit. I certify that I have inspected the exterior bridge, steel wood, stairways, or egress connected to the building on this address. To the best of my knowledge, information, and belief, these egress components is in conformity with the provisions of the Mass Building Code and certified to their structural adequacy and safety. That's what's been going in Massachusetts for 50 to 75 years. Sadly, some of the stamp whores just drive by a building. As long as that fire escape is not on the ground, they can roll down their window or touch the power window button. But what? What do you get? You get a fee, put that in your car, you don't get out of your car. You look up and you fell on one of these and do what? because it has this golden parachute. What's the golden parachute? To the best of my knowledge, information, and belief, that day, as soon as he puts it in drive and it hits the first right corner, what happens? It's no longer that day. And somebody says, well, what happened? The year later, somebody got hurt on it. Any comments on that statement? Anybody have used on copying this document from the past? Because a lot of times, if you don't have one of these for your city, and this is a Massachusetts document, they erase their name, put their name on top, sign it. Anybody ever seen one of these in their city? Yes, no? So that's why I'm confident that if you look at the full confidence test, I've shrunk it, not for purposes of you know, testing everybody's eyeballs here, but it's a lot bigger. This is usually a 6-page questionnaire. Okay? Page 1, 25 yes, no questions are not applicable. No opinions. And the main question is there any rust inside that connection? So we take the fire escape all apart. So the first thing you do when you put in a fire escape, what's the first thing you stick on the wall? Brackets. Right? So I don't know anything about those brackets. They rivets, they bolts, they are properly tied into the building. Is it screw bolted into the building or is it cemented into the building? There's a question in every one of those. Legs to the ground, there's a question. There's three types. Legs to the ground, screw bolted into the building, and then cemented into the building. What's the next thing you put on? The platform? I want to know anything about that platform. You got grading with those little spacers, they're all rotted on the inside. And when they open up, what happens to your foot? It's inside, it snaps your leg or snaps your ankle. Little kids' legs are pretty right around, they start falling through these. And then there's a frame all around, usually a lot of times, so there's grading in the frame. I want to know everything about that. Is there any rust in the frame? Once you get on the grading in the frame, what's the next thing you put up? The railings. Are these railings tied to the frame? And are these railings tied back to the building? There's a question. It's only 25 questions. Then from there, I'm going to go up or down. I'm on the second floor. I'm either going to go up one of the floor. So now we're talking about the stringers. I want to know about the stringer. Clips at the bottom of the string, clips at the top. I want to know about all the trim. I want to know about all the railings. It's a question. Going down now, I can either have a stair going down, stringers, or I can have a cantilever, or I can have a ladder. It could be a fixed ladder, a drop ladder with cables, or a cantilever. So there's a question in here for every one of them. Sometimes you're coming off a building and land on a roof. Guess what you're supposed to have on a roof? Flat or pitch? A catwalk. There's a catwalk question in here. How about electrical near the fire escape? There's a question on here. How about flammables on a fire escape? It's a question in here. How about lights on a fire escape? Not required when they were installed. It's a question that says, hey, there's no lights on this thing, right? Yeah, there's no lights on this thing. It's one of the questions. Talks about the paint, yes. There's a question on it. It's one of the last questions. Has the owner been notified that EPA rules apply? Anything older than 1978 is presumed to have lead, which means no welding, and whoever's going to scrape and paint this thing must be an EPA renovator licensed person or face $37,500 fines per incident. And I know in the whole country they have a lot of inspectors, but they got 4 in the whole country. And are they sharing that $37,500 fine with that? Think about the commission sale. They make you guys all extended sales, right? You guys get 20% of any EPA violations that you guys can find on your day-to-day duty. You know what happened? Just so you know, I had a guy that we did a class on, and I think it was San Bar, it was further down. It was somebody else that actually worked off commission on the building inspector, way down by the Cape. We got the city now. And he basically, his salary was based on how many permits he wrote a year. So he actually had to drive around, and whenever he find rubble on the side of the street, he'd go, hey, what's going on? Oh, you're burning. And then his salary was capped. He goes, the worst is when some utility comes in is digging some $2 million something or whatever, because then he kills me, because I make all my pay, I make my salary that hit, because they cap it, you can't exceed. And then the rest of the year, I don't feel like going out dumpster diving anymore to see who's got plaster in the dumpster, you know what I'm saying? I thought, dude, this could happen. If everybody had a lot of position, it'd be a different game, you know? Yeah, controlling the streets, you know? Right. And then the last question on here, guys, is question number 25. It's the catch-all. You know, you've got a unicorn type thing. The guy's got the barrel of oil underneath this thing. So question 25 is the catch-all. You have a question, and if you didn't know where to put it, and it's all yes, no questions. So whenever you have a yes, no questionnaire, what happens to the structural engineers and architects? You think they want to sign some documents? They don't want to sign these. They want opinions. It is my opinion. And we threw it on there at the beginning. You know, the best of my information, all to believe an opinion, the following statements are true. But these statements are true. So we threw that in there, because a lot of them, as long as they see that, they think, well, I'm actually saying that the 25 statements are about to make is true. So if they lie that there is no rust in that connection on this document, there is rust in that connection, because they can take money. It even asks right here, did you walk it or did you look at it from the ground? It's a question. And it says here, if you're going to certify, there's only three ways to certify it. Certify by low test, certify it by other evidence of strength, means a full refurb, and or I even put in here, certified by an opinion affidavit accepted by the AHA, you see that one of these, for use with an opinion disclaimer of liability. So I'll sign an opinion affidavit with this, and I'll say, hey, the owner has to sign a document that says, if there's an incident on that fire escape, they will hold me harmless. Because you didn't let me do what the law says. The law says I either give a low test or I give other evidence of strength. And you didn't give me either. You just wanted ready for its intended use. Isn't that pretty much what the one for 1001.3? Isn't that what it's saying on 1001.3? The best of my knowledge, information, and egress component within the. The egress component is in conformity with the provisions. How great is that? So these things are 50, 75, 100 years old, and they haven't been inspected or load tested in many cases. You probably look on the jacket, you can't find the lost certificate in your city. The one that's really good is Boston. Boston has a lot. But now we got Lowell, we got Everett. They're starting to, get onto the bandwagon and say, we need a program here. So if you don't have one, you have structures in your city. And the way that I would get into it, ease my way into it over the next 3 to 5 years, just start a program that says, we want a preliminary, we want a preload evaluation. And that is just to say whether it's ready for its intended use. And that very low cost information, you still want to report, but you want a preliminary. You will then decide how aggressive you're going to be dealing with that residential or commercial building. But at least you're going to get a tag put on it. Because at the end of it all, in the preliminary, they're going to have a tag. And usually it's going to be a yellow or a red. You'll take care of all the reds over the next 1 to 3 years. You'll take care of all the yellows over the next 3 to 5 years. And then by the fifth year, you're going to be rolling in this. And a lot of times, you're going to start commercially first, because they're in business. And then you're going to ease into the residentials, 1 and 2s. Finally get picked up towards the end. But 3s and 4s and 5s and 6s, they're going to get hit under the IPC. So the additional questions, I'll show some more paperwork that I have. Any other questions? You're kind of shy. You know what I was told? It's that 10-minute break. 10-minute break, guys. So I'm going to go from that, just so you guys know. My headquarters is at 10 Square Lane underneath the Purple Line stop. So I'm an odd duck. I own the property underneath the Purple Line. I have a commuter rail running in my head every day. But that's my national headquarters. And I have an office there if you guys want to train. I can train about 8. It'll go bigger very soon because we're expanding, but you want to have your team come down, I'll teach you in an office environment. Or I can come to your place if you have a seating for eight, and I'll teach you. And Mark, we did the same thing over there, right? We went to Everett, and we just sat in the room, we chatted, we did some downtown walk-arounds. So Everett is what we call a model city. So if you don't want to suffer through the pain and put this and trying this out, just call Everett. Say, hey, who yelled at you? What did you write? What did you do wrong? How fast is it flying? Or how fast is it not flying? Because just because it takes, I said this, you guys remember, I said this is going to take 3 to 5 years. We did a class a year ago, and he actually came from Lowell. And they've been doing it for 5 years. So it's not going to happen overnight. It's really a chain by putting it on a checklist button. So we can teach you how to class, and also do WebEx. You guys are familiar with GoToMeetings.com. So if you're very small, and you have 1, 2, or 3 people total, we can do a WebEx. I could be in my office, do WebEx. We can have a meeting. And you can do a 1-hour class pretty quick. We don't charge for the classes.
Okay?
So this is a little bit about who we are, what we're doing. If you go to fireescapesboston.com, so every city, we make one of these free websites. Fireescapesboston.com, fireescapesphiladelphia.com, fireescapesseattle.com, fireescapeschicago.com, fireescapesdallas.com. So wherever something's happening. So if you go here, what are you going to see? Every question that we had in here, you can go find it here. So, Linda, did we do a Firescapes ever? No. So this represents, we also have a fireescapesma.com representing all the cities. So if you don't want to use the Boston, if there's any problem with Boston. Guess the Boston guys did today, no? Change his name. So we have fireescapes.ma. Guys, here's your building code. Right there. Okay? So if anybody says, hey, I have a fire escape, I just want your violation, what should I do? Say, hey, go to fireescapesma.com. All your questions are going to be there. And you're going to have your 1001.3. You're also going to have the 2012, which is also the 2015 IFC. There's the exact code every 5 years. You're going to have the IBC here, you're going to have the NFPA. The authority having jurisdiction shall approve any fire escape by load test or other evidence of strength. And you also have the OSHA 19.10.37. It's all there. So when somebody's yelling and freaking and calling the mayor, what do you say? Hey mayor, look on this website, fireescapesma or fireescapesboston.com. Scrolling down some more. 5-step certification. This is all free. You don't have to register, you don't have to do anything. This is just informative. Because if you're going to start writing violations, people want to know what to do, you can send them here. Schedule, professional, submit evaluation report, issue certificate if passed, or contact your local building official if something went wrong. Pretty simple. Next, we have videos. These are typical videos. If it passes, you believe old fire escapes sometimes pass? Well, here's one, right? Click on here, this is us walking through why that fire escape passed. Okay? If it failed, here's a video of if it failed commercially. Here's a video of if it fails residentially. Okay? Scrolling down. Confidence test. Click on that, you're going to have a copy of this confidence test. You can print it. It's a PDF. Blank. You know who can use this? Any engineer, any architect. It basically, because it has no name on it. And if he says, oh, is this a Massachusetts red document? Say, as a matter of fact, it isn't. But, oh, I can't sign such a document. It's not going to do it. Say, oh, you know what? Then you don't. Then you should. But you know the 25 questions? Why don't you write them on your letterhead and answer the same 25 questions, more or less, on your letterhead. Now it'll be your document. Right. Who invented the airbag? Mercedes. Why didn't Mercedes patent it? Because they would have made billions. Because they said it's more important that everybody in the auto industry has access to this for the public safety. Because we have worse car manufacturers, but this airbag should be in every car. And today it is. But we're killing on the patent market. They said, so this is not copyrighted. So if anybody gives you a hard time about the guy who made this up, so you know what, you're right, I don't like him either. I don't like his questions. But his questions are your letter. And that'll be your famous paperwork. Okay? So let's keep going down. Right? At the very bottom, you guys see the disclaimer? It says that because Cisco's the only guy that even wanted to do this crazy crap. Here's my disclaimer of, you know, I'm Firescape inspectors, I'm Firescape engineers, I'm Firescape services, because there's only one guy out there doing this stuff. So there is the transparency to show that you are getting this information from a guy who's in this business, so it's there. Anybody know what a load test is? Well, there's a part of it here for load testing, here. To the right side, see this part here with all the load testing? Click here for load testing. You click on this, so you never leave this page. Look. It'll open up Firescape load testing. Guess what's on there? How to use sandbags, how to use water, how to use, if you think you can reverse engineer it, if you're a pretty smart guy. And video. So it's all here. Okay? Somebody says, oh, somebody got hurt. What do? I need a lawyer. Oh, we got to pay for that. Firescape Law. It's only $39 million if you win. Firescape Law. And what you have here, this is the nightmare page. This is all fatalities that you want. And I'm probably 6 to 8 cases. My best case, a guy that in San Diego carrying a hawk, and this hawk is a Valencia Hotel, very posh Valencia Hotel in Vallejo. And he's got this hawk that chases seagulls so that they don't poop on the very rich people down below. So on the way out, he's like, oh, I can't go walk through the entrance to the hotel with a hawk. I'm going to go down the fire escape. I'm going to go down the fire escape. And then he gets to this cantilever. And the cantilever is all the way along, but it has a block. Can you block that egress? Steps over, holding his hawk. Okay, he's holding his hawk. And now you're supposed to have a release mechanism, right? Or no release mechanism. You're supposed to step on it. What does a cantilever do? So you can activate it by stepping on the first 25%. As soon as you step on it, she starts going down, right? And then he controls himself because he has a lock. One hand on the fire escape, one hand on the lock. So he steps over this obstruction rail, and then they put a locking mechanism on this obstruction rail in the bushes outside the fire escape. That the green had grown all up. So he's got this lock. He's got this cantilever, it's a plank now, it's like a gangplank for a pirate ship, you know what I'm saying? So he takes his hawk and he starts walking out. Finally walk out far enough that the latch, the locking mechanism, can you have a locking mechanism of any kind on the fire escape? You can have a single latch that requires a special knowledge of the lease arm, but never can it be a locking mechanism. And that locking mechanism, physics, so much force out on such a little mechanism here, his weight, including the hawk, and he dropped like a stone, ripped his Achilles and stuff like that. That's the kind of instances we have. So they have very extreme injuries, deaths, and stuff like that, and then you got, he's the best one I got right now, the hawk.
How is the hawk?
The hawk's got to get out of here. The hawk was flew away, and while he was hurt, I mean, he actually had to hobble over and put the hawk back in the inside the car, and then they have to go to the hospital. So, what I want to state there, you guys have examples here of load testing, all these, NFPA.org, and if you go to the very top, see what it says fire officials and building officials, industry standards. and click on that, takes it to the National Fire Association. And what you have on there is not only does it have all kinds of great information, stories, after story, but it also has on the seminars all the classes we've taught nationwide, all over the country. The best one to watch, Portland, Oregon. They've only done it for 10 years. And they're still kicking the bugs out of it. It's not perfect. Okay? So, everybody clear? If you need any information, firescapesma.com or firescapesboston. And all these websites are exactly the same, we just changed the name on top. Okay? And a lot of them always say contact the local building official. So let's just take a look, one last look at this book. You've got quite a bit of information. If anybody wants to give me their card and have us put together a program for you, that's going to take 3 to 5 years. That's going to start off with a Redbird's Intended Use Program, which is basically a safe structures initiative, just to start the tagging to help save firemen and people. So this is not a certification program. This is, and then from there you can have a 3 to 5 year, but let's take a look. First page, plenty of information on how to properly inspect, repair, and paint fire escape. Number two, you got lead paint, so lead paint is covered. You got to watch out for the welding witch doctors, okay? Number three, this is the very first checklist I have ever made in Seattle. And you can see a lot of the questions just got better. It's the same question, basically asking yes, no questions, no longer. Can you have opinions? So Seattle, Portland, LA, Tacoma, they ask yes, no questions. It's the standard checklist that you have for sprinkler systems. They have a checklist. You've never had a fire escape checklist. Pictures with today's digital photography. They don't have to be perfect. They don't have to be in a beautiful format like this. 4 per page, 6 per page, 9 per page. I want digital pictures. I have no time to go down there as a building inspector and look. When you give me the preliminary, I want a checklist done. It says you walked it. And I want pictures so I can determine whether I'm going to give this client 3 months, 12 months, or 1 to 3 years, or 3 to 5 years in the process of the certification. At all times until it's 100% fully certified, who gets all the liability? The owner. Push it. This is a document from the U.S. from Massachusetts. This is a construction control document. Anything that's commercial over 33,000 cubic, right? So what I did is I took a mass document and I just put it on Firescape. So if you want, you can even use one of these documents as a construction control document for Firescape. Want to repair a Firescape? This is how you fix tread, bolts, railings. Free information. This is a copy of what's been out there for 75 years. To the best of my information, I believe it's an opinion affidavit that has gone into the jackets of many buildings. It's been abused beyond belief, this one single document. And by the way, structural engineers and registered architects are not the main signers in the city of Boston. Guess who is? Licensed installers, it's right there. So if I can fix a fire escape in Boston, never pull a permit, and I can sign off on my own work in the city of Boston, and I never pull a permit, when is the job done? After I change it. What work do I do to it? Who cares? Nobody knows what to look for. If I weld it and nobody catches me, guess what happens? Is she sound that day at least? And if I didn't catch the building on fire, I'd kill 2 firemen in the process. It's a quick buck. So how many $3,000 days can you have sending out 2 guys with a welding machine? As many as I can get. All fire escapes in the U.S. are built this way. None of them do anything different. This is how it's tied into the building. Every fire escape has not changed in 100 years. They may look a little bit different, but how they're attached and how they're bolted, how they're cemented into the building. So nothing's ever changed. They built it right 100 years ago, they're building it right today. This shows you catwalks over the roof. Every time I get on a fire escape and there's nothing on that roof that gets snow and ice during the winter, it's missing a catwalk. When it gets to the end, it needs a staircase to the ground. But if I turn around and I see ladders, catwalk, I will tell the building official, I believe the missing component here is a ladder. Whether you accept it or not, it's not up to me. It's a pre-existing non-conforming condition subject to the building official's approval. So, catwalks, cantilevers. What cantilevers are still being built today? There's a law out there that says no new fire escapes. How many have heard that law? You know what it applies to? No new fire escapes on new construction. But every box, church, outhouse, factory, mansion, could be some other four walls situated pig house, I don't care. Can I turn it into a usable structure, whether it's residential or commercial, and put a fire escape on it? Yes or no? The answer is yes. If I've exhausted all means of putting two egresses inside that building, I will have the right to put a fire escape on the outside. Not through a window, it's got to come out of the door, out to a platform, 7-Eleven rise and run, 36 inches wide, 2 grade, or a cantilever to grade, no ladders. Is that a true statement? So a lot of your buildings in the times, you're knocking them down, you're missing the point. Fire escape can save a lot of your old structure because it's still an approved means of egress. No new fire escape for new construction. So, at the casino over there, to save some room, I was trying to offer them some fire escapes there to all the casinos, you know, but they said, guys, you know, Martin said, no fire escapes. Joking around, but yes. Great question. The setback rule doesn't apply to fire escapes. Oh, does it? Anybody? So if you enclose it, is there setback rules? You don't enclose it, is there any setback rules?
If the zoning, are you saying,
So is a fire escape subject to setback?
Yes, I would say 100%.
Anybody else? So now you're saying, depending on zoning is written?
Yes, sir, that's what we're talking about, is depending on the zoning.
So each, you say each locality may have.
I'm gonna tell you, the state has no exemption. I'm telling you, master law 48, there's no exemption for fire escape. But it has to be that way. So I think the master law section two. Without a permit. Yes. So what I'm talking about, I'm getting pretty close now.
So now we've got this such a word, because everybody's saying, so can everybody just raise the volume on it and say, what? Your belief is that it's subject to setback, no matter what you put on the side on that. I'm just saying, in my history, since I was written, it was in papers required for primarily this attack. Fire escape for literally built on the back, on the front, on the side, and there was never, maybe because the zoning didn't care, but the fire escape got built because that's the only way they could sweep one in there. A lot of times, it was a staircase, or it was something that would allow them to last, and be on the special permit, special approval, to allow that special fit, that is my own. But it's a great question, that's all going to talk. I mean, I'm not the answer guy, I'm not the guy that is come up every day. And one city may deny, the other city may allow. And then, I don't know what the setbacks are, but that's the same point, a lot of people. All right, I'm about to end it here. So guys, the tags, these are what the tags look like. 7 to 10 feet off the ground. Permanently attached to the building. And the one that the firemen are looking for are the white ones. They can see that running into a dark alley, smoky alley. They see white, they can climb up. They see red, they see yellow. Red, they're not gonna see too many reds. There's a lot of red that can converge to yellow pretty quickly. But a lot of the yellow they're gonna see there saying that summer rain has been made with the city official on how long they got basically to take their fire escape test from ready for intended use to a full certification. It could be months, it could be years. Each city will have their own individual way of looking at that. Questions on the tags? Now this is required in some states. For example, Portland, Oregon, you must have a tag in the fire escape. In Seattle, you must have a tag in the fire escape. Okay? Fire protection equipment has to have a fire escape tag. So if you ever want to check out another city, Los Angeles, Reg 4, they cover everything under fire protection. If you go to Regulation 4 in Los Angeles, everything's covered. Sprinklers, alarms, fire escape, pumps, everything's covered. Take a look at the last page. And the last page is, what is it that, what last page, what does it say? The way you're going to get to this is to put it on a list. Don't need any special money, don't put it on a task force, because as soon as you think you have to hire some guys to go up the fire escape, believe me, there's a lot of other things in the same city that need your attention. Okay? And so they're here. You gotta put it on the list. As soon as you put it on the list and you work with your fire department and your health department, things start popping. Don't go looking for fire escape. That fire escape will find you. These are some of our downtown walkarounds that we've done. So next year, you guys want to do a 6-hour tour. One of the greatest things you can do is not have as many people, but then as in the afternoon, either watch videos of us walking around downtown or physically go into a downtown that has a lot of fire escape and look at fire escape from down below. You do that with Lowell, you do that with Everett. So it's great walking your own downtown and looking. Okay? And as always, if you want to use the back of your book, just put it somewhere. Frank, this is the picture that started off the classes that I've done. Because all you have to do is just take care of one fire, so you can save one life, one fire, one child. Anything after that is another good bonus. But if somebody says, why you made me fix my fire, so you just hold this up for a second. These people die. Question, yes. There's another question over here.
Fire.
still protected from the weather. Because one of the reasons they eliminated fire escapes is because nobody maintained it. But sometimes you get a super high structure, and in some cases, you do need some sort of power or something. For example, in Philadelphia, a lot of these residential buildings go into a fire tower on residential and commercial buildings. You actually leave your building, then you go into a mobile fire tower and have a roof. Fire tower is on its branch, but it's totally isolated from the rest of the building. So that's the only city that has fire towers tied to residential and commercial structures. So that's what my opinion was on that, is that sometimes there's a third means of egress when you get to certain heights, or they need to increase, as you know, inside the buildings. There's a company, if you ever want to get, there was a guy that invented right after the tower broke down, he invented something similar to the cruise boat that actually sits on top of a 20, 50 story building. It actually comes off the side and drops down this elevator that opens up into five elevators. And basically comes all the way down and feeds firemen into the building when it goes back up, feeds five firemen into five more. At the same time, the firemen put all these people into the elevator and then they drop it down. And they do that all day long. Costs about $2 million, $3 million for that system, per system. The bag systems, where you basically get in, the credential that actually had us do a demo for them on how to get through the glass of the, John Hancock. And they wanted the bag systems to do good before. That means one of those wires, the control and send device, no matter how much weight, and they would have to do it. So it's been conversations, but that kind of all quieted down when they started, that's something. Somebody had a question on this side?
Why aren't insurance companies leaving the
ambulance? Oh, you hit the insurance button, which is great. They are. So the insurance companies now, we're dealing with Philadelphia insurance companies. Not because they're based out of, but they do nationwide. And so a lot of, we're doing a Mason's Lodge in Illinois. And that was one of the requirements, because they're now seeing these lawsuits going out and saying, hey, whether the state is enforcing it or not, we're going to enforce a certification and a little bit. So I've had conversations with, on the WebEx or OpenMeetings.com with underwriters. They've asked me what's going on out there. So I think that's coming very shortly. That they got a mandate that every building may ensure be certified and load tested. And once they're there, whether the code wants it or not, they can say without a load test, we don't want to pay, we want a load test. So that hasn't touched. Yes?
Cisco, we're having a little trouble determining who I should allow as the AHA, right, to do these inspections.
No, the AHA is good. The power of having jurisdiction shall be set by the local. So you're going to accept.
Yes.
So
what about the AHA? I'm having a little trouble understanding who I should let. I have a little resistance to letting a guy who has a boss from another place come into my city in effort and say I'm certified to do this. By what experience has should they show me? I'm okay with the doors registered for engineers, PEs, and I'm okay with architects because they understand what I'm having trouble with is should I let a guy with a CSL do it? Should I let a guy with a wellness license do it? Can you talk about that?
Sure. So what he's talking about is right here in the code. It says right here, the fire escape shall be examined and or tested and certified for structural adequacy by a Massachusetts professional engineer or others qualified and acceptable to building officials. So you still can say, yeah, Boston takes your G3 license, I don't. Or you can say, I'll allow you G3 to do a peer review of a structural engineer. Or you can do one, but you can't do both. You would examine, great, you can examine, but I can't have you repaired. And if you do get it repaired, because so few of you, then I will not allow you to sign without hiding an independence. So the fact is that the fox in the hen house. I know. I have a G2 license. I'm an other acceptable to building systems. Sometimes. I have plenty of conversations. Yeah, you're great, it's a product class, but I don't want you to sign the documents. And I have plenty of PEs and plenty of registered architects that will not sign my document. But that's a very good question. It's basically saying, does that mean I'm in even a about it. I use the example, I use the analogy is that, you know, if you're gonna, you know, groom cats and dogs, and that's what you've been doing for 50 to 75 years, it's easy. But as soon as somebody comes in with a skunk and says, listen, I need you to groom this skunk, a lot of these cats and dogs, people will say, listen, I can wash any animal, but I won't groom this skunk. I just don't want to. I got plenty of dogs and cats. Why would I even want to touch this skunk? And what's the rule? We don't know. Worse than, I don't know if it's going to pee on me or not pee on me. So 75 years, you've never touched it. The wealthy witch doctors have had a free fall on it. They're still there today. And in 2014, they killed two firemen. Well, let's bring that up. You know what they did in Boston now? Because of 2014. Pissed me off, but I called anybody and everybody, but how many classes have I taught in Boston? How many fire department classes have I taught in Boston? Throw myself at them all the time. Easy fix. I heard now that I think Gary Moshe is no longer there. There's been some changes. I'll try again. I think I was on one of your. One time I had a Boston guy that was with me one time. From a previous class, I think I hit him or something, but they're part of your group, right? So, the biggest issue with this is 75 years, this has to be built. So, you know who can inspect it? Construction engineer, professional director, others acceptable to the building official. You know who can fix it? Ornamental iron workers. Why? Because they build these things. They normally have 3 to 5 guys, they'll have workers' comp and liability, they'll pull permits. They'll have a license, whether it's a CSL or a G3, and then you can make your decisions whether they can pull a permit. Who else? Welding guys can fix these fire escapes because they have that certified welding certificate, and they can use that to come in and say, I'm not going to weld anything because it has lead all over the place, but you know what? My other tools in my truck, I can break every bolt, I can replace any member, and I'm going to drill and bolt this whole fire escape back together because it's monkey see, monkey repeat, monkey replace. So those guys are not getting kicked out of the box. They just get kicked out of the box to weld this thing and get $3,000 hits. We call them the welding witch doctors. After dancing, chicken blood, feathers. You know who else can fix this? General contractors. They put up metal buildings and structures. They can get into this stuff. It's a Lego set. It's a fire escape with stairs. These guys, they do this stuff all day long. Bring them in. But when? In Portland, for 10 years, every so often on a year or 2 year basis, we have a class, and you'll see it on video, and in this class I have the City of Portland Building Department, architects and engineers, vendors, repair guys and painters, and my God, the tomato starts flying. What do you mean, and you can't do it, they love it, because it brings, all the questions get answered. I can do this, okay, well, Building Department, you're gonna let this guy do that? Nope. Hey, fire department, and so on. So this is going to take 3 to 5 years to get your head wrapped around. But step one is you need something to start, and it's a safe structures initiative. Is it ready for its intended use? And you're taking on no liability. I just want to put a tag on it because the fire code says every fire protection equipment needs a tag. We have a local ordinance. If you're waiting for this to come from the top down, don't hold your breath. But on the local level, you can ask for every fire escape must have a tag. What's a tag? It's a certified tag. If it doesn't get a white tag, which is certified, which puts the liability on the structural engineer who just load tested that or signed off other evidence of strength, which is what kind of liability from signing off other evidence of strength? If there's a failure, it's going to be a bolt failure. Who do we all sue? The bolt manufacturer. Right? But then, that's the certification. But if you're holding a yellow tag for 3 years, whose liability is it? Is it the city? No. Is it the owner? Yeah. Did he sign a document saying so when he gave you a preliminary document, which is similar to the one, the Philadelphia one? And right here has a signature for the professional, and has a signature for the owner. Says, I have been told of a condition, and I shouldn't start within 30 days. It's been 3 years. What have you been doing? You've just been hitting the reds first, the yellows second, the the ones that are going to be white, you call them. As soon as you get it certified, you are under liability. Otherwise, you know, it's a $39 million. Well, is that a $39 million? Seeing as whether I let it roll, but there's a lot of liability. There's lawsuits going on like crazy. They always, and they dragged in Philadelphia. And Philadelphia got dragged in, and they settled. This thing didn't want to work. They settled. But then all of a sudden, this March, we get this letter that just came out. Everyone in the city, it doesn't even, they didn't even have a list, so they sent it to everybody on the 6am. Get your fire station. We have to call, I don't have a fire station, so I get inspected. Like, but a lot of times, the reason why they do need a fire station inspection is because they have a three family, and there's no fire station. And what's the easiest question you can ask anybody? Do you have two means of egress inside your building that go from the top floor apartment to the ground floor and out the door? Do you have two of those, one in the front and one in the back? Well, in the front, it goes all the way to the third, in the back, it's just the first and second floor. Yeah, you need a fire station. But I don't have one. Yeah, they think you need one. Because that's why they sent it to you, because it got converted. And that, what used to be the main center and the butler's quarters upstairs is now, which didn't need it when it was a single family, but now that you illegally, not illegally, but now that it's converted to a three family, you are actually missing the second means of egress out of your third floor alone. So that's it. And, oh, and get all done by 11. So you guys see, so, the only way that this is going to happen is you have to take an approach. You have to have a 3 to 5 year initiation, then a 5 to 10 year, you know, it'll become common sense. Just make it part of a checklist. But since Cincinnati, since Philly came out with all this stuff, we really are now pushing. We never really pushed this before, but either Everett or Lowell, we never pushed the ready for its intended use. And what that is you're not even doing an inspection. Called a preliminary, because in their code it says before the inspection you're supposed to review all the documentation associated with that fire station or stop. So if there isn't one, I can't go do an inspection. I got to do a preliminary so that I can have a what has happened on the fire station and was there any previous work done. So this preliminary is what I sent to the city official, and now they are looking for one piece of the document, that is it safe, unsafe, or unsafe or living in danger, signed by two people that are informed on the situation, and what's the recommended start date? Imminent danger says right here, clearly, 24 hours, you gotta call everybody, hey, you know, get it fixed or get some scaffolding, you know, that kind of thing. But otherwise, an imminent danger, I no longer deal with the client, it's the client in the city saying, so what, I see your photos, I see your thing here. You've got to start in 30 days. Do you have a repair report? No, the guy wanted $5,000. Okay, not him then, who else? I don't know what calling around. Well, you better call around some more because I'm gonna be coming down. And I either want to see the fire station in repairs within the recommended 30 days, or then I can extend 30, 60, 90. Just get started on it. Otherwise, I get this, there's nothing you better want to scaffold, or I'll order it for you and send it to Bill. But quiet. You guys have, I'm done.